us that wants to portray us in a bad light.
Exactly, but what about the other, what about the river? What about a European-American person saying, why would you write such a thing? It makes them look bad. What about, what is that about?
It makes the European look bad?
No, it makes black people look bad.
Oh,
what about that? What is that about?
Wow.
Right, that's what we're, yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
So there's the don't show the dirty laundry thing for the black community, and then for the white, what is that?
I would say for them, it's just, it's, the question would be, why do you do that? Why do you do business out in the street like that? And Europeans have a long tradition of keeping stuff behind closed doors.
But Walter White, his business is in the street. His underwear was hanging off of the Winnebago.
Yeah, but he's American.
But I'm saying European-American is a nice way of saying white people.
Uh-huh.
I'm saying white people. Why, what's the difference?
There's a difference between the European white person and the American white person.
But I'm saying European-Americans, like I'm saying, that's my nice way of saying white people. What do you think?
I mean, I think it's just an issue of, like, some people have to prove, like, it's like, give me evidence that you are respectable citizens. I need more evidence. I do not just go ahead and assume that these are equal and respectable citizens. And I think that's the problem. Is like, well, why aren't you giving me the evidence that I need to believe in you as a person? And it's like, well, you shouldn't need evidence. You should just believe in me as a person. But I think that's the mentality behind, like, why would you make your own group of people look bad? Is like, why aren't you giving me the fuel that I need to be a decent human being and have faith in you?
The Jewish people, Philip Roth was the big breakthrough writer that dared to show things that maybe people didn't want to be presented as at that time, but he did it with humor.
I do think it's a matter too, like individual actions. I mean, like a character like Walter White, for example, is a criminal. He's doing terrible things. He's killing people. He's hurting people.
Right.
The people in, say, Top Dog, Underdog, are mostly out for their own survival. So there's more of a redeeming factor to, say, those characters than, say, Walter White, who is really more of an anti-hero than a villain. But what I think is cool about that show is that he starts off as being something of, you know, an anti-hero, that then becomes a full-on villain by the end of the show. That's really the
I just watched the first episode, honestly. But it was great. It was just too, like, violent, you know.
It's good,
But, I mean, it's brilliantly written.
Yeah.
But I think what it sounds like it comes down to is that we allow some people to be people in all their complexity, and we allow other people not to be people. You're not a person. You're just a soundbite or a sound
clip.
Or a representation of something. It's like the cliff notes to your personhood. You know? Oh, Crystal's here. Now we can start. Crystal's here. No, we haven't started because we were waiting for you. We were waiting for all of you. We're back, and this is Watch Me Work. And for those of you who haven't been here before, we live stream through the courtesy of HowlRound. We hang out in the public theater once a week on Mondays. And basically, Watch Me Work is a free writing class. That's what it is at its heart, right? It's also a play. Years ago, like Jesse Alec here, who was the producer, was the, you know, we sat around. We were sitting around, and I needed to write a play for Jesse Alec's festival. And I said, I don't have time to write a play. But I said, what I will do is I'll make a play that consists of me sitting on stage writing. And that was the play. And we started that. Because I thought it was really important. I also play musical instruments, and I learned so much by watching people do things. And there's a whole history, a whole understanding of the way people learn things by watching. If you have ever read, like, The Inner Game of Tennis or whatever. Yay, Serena! We love you, you're the best. But if you've ever read that, the Inner Game of Tennis, there's this whole understanding of how we learn things by watching. We just watch people do things. And that's one way of learning. We watch people play the guitar on the banjo. And that contact knowledge, that contact power comes. So I thought, gosh, writers, we don't have anything to watch. We watch their work. We watch their work, their plays. We watch, we look at their novels. But we don't really get to watch them work. I thought, how fun to have people watch me work. So this is what it looks like. Isn't that funny? I know. So maybe, you know, those people online, you know, when you're lost and lonely, when you do not have a friend, and you need to see what it looks like to be a writer, you can just turn it on. HowlRound and the Public Theater, they archive this. You can turn it on. What's fun about this show also is that we do a Q&A after we work together. So it gives everybody, whether you're here in the lobby of the Public Theater Live, or you're in the
Ask questions. The hashtag is New Play, and then you can also send the hashtag HowlRound as well.
Awesome. I'm sorry.
It's all good.
yay, Brittany. Send us a tweet. Brittany might remind you when we stop working. She'll remind you again. Have a tweet, and then we can answer your questions live. We can certainly answer your questions here.
We're
gonna have a timer. Okay, just to make sure that I don't like this goes off and I'm in my. I forget. Look at all this paper. How are you kidding? I'm not gonna use all this.
Yes.
Yes. Eventually, Father comes home with the words. Oh, there it is. It's already written. Nice. And I use a typewriter because it reminds us of long, long ago. Okay, ready? So we ready? I'm gonna do this. Ready?
I know about this typewriter anymore. These are really complex. I had to take it off and make the ribbon go the other way. I didn't know how to do it. That. My hands got all dirty. Anyway, yeah, they no longer teach, apparently they no longer teach children, right? Is that right, Crystal? Crystal has kids. They no longer teach children. So they can't sign their name?
What?
And soon we won't even have to drive.
Yeah.
I mean, I know some people don't, like, you live in LA, you have to drive or whatever like that. But I'm talking about the rest of us. You just get in your car and it's going to be safer and it's going to be better. And, but I know back in the day, when we all lived in caves, we learned, we knew how to make a fire with just sticks. And people were like, no, no, just use a big lighter, man. Bullshit. And now I don't know how to make a fire. Sticks, do you? I bet you could like type on a computer. I bet you know how to code or whatever. So you know how to code. You do. You know how. Yeah. I remember you got those skills. Can you make a fire in the woods?
Yeah, so I can do both.
You can. You can. See.
See. And you can.
And you can drive. And you can drive.
And I can drive.
And you can write in cursive.
No, but I can't write in print either. I have no motor skills. You can see.
This doesn't count
it's
as a
not
motor
writing.
Skill?
No. It's not writing.
You're a good writer. Stop. Okay, so does anybody have any really big pressing questions? Is this what we're supposed to do now? Yes. Anybody have any big pressing questions? Or not even pressing? So you can ask questions, specific questions about your work. And it's amazing how we can troubleshoot and problem solve without ever having read your entire because all the questions are at the end of the day. Yes?
How do you keep yourself from repeating vomiting it out, or did you get out your first draft or second draft?
Great question. What's your name?
Garland.
Garland? Garland. And Garland asks, how does one keep oneself from repeating? As we vomit it out, we're talking about one draft for one project.
Yeah, like if you do like your first draft of a poem or a play, whatever it is, you got, let's say, a play and you end up with three acts, well, you probably repeat yourself several times. So then how do you kind of keep yourself from doing that in the first place?
Right, good question.
Or else you just got to live with it and you go on and edit.
Right, so I'm guessing you're a writer, yes, and you write some things and you've written some things and perhaps you've tried this. Just vomit it out method, which I think is a great thing to do. And you're trying the sort of write now, rewrite later method, which is great and very smart. And your concern is perhaps I might be repeating myself, maybe.
Yeah, well, yeah. It's like, how do you do less work?
Ah.
You know, because it's like, it seems like, okay, if I do this out, then I have to go back and spend X amount of hours editing and getting the rip of it.
Yes.
X amount of hours that I could have done something.
I understand. Well, see, how you do less work is actually, it's a trick. How you do less work is actually remove the concern that you're having right now. And go ahead and repeat yourself. And not to worry about repeating yourself. That's actually how you remove less work, because if you remove the worry is going to, like, slow you down. Right? I mean, I could use an analogy and I'm not going to. Concern. But you know what I'm talking about. So worry kind of slows it down, right? So if you're not in a state of worry, then it actually will allow you to continue on and not be looking over your shoulder and wondering, like you're running. And you don't see any of those like Usain Bolt or whoever they are, you know, running. And they're not looking like that when they're running, they're looking like this. Okay? So yeah, remove that and allow yourself to freely write first and rewrite later. But you do that all the time, right?
Yeah.
I do that. Yeah. You move up all here. You need a brand or something.
How do you know when a character has the, it's a weird question, when they have the correct name, because my main character has changed names at least 3 times now,
right.
So I'm not sure about nomenclature for this one guy, but how do you know when you've given your character the right, like, title?
Right,
yeah,
right.
That makes sense.
Yes, that does make sense. How do you know when you've given your character the right name?
And it's funny, I can't say that it's because he won't change his name, because a lot of my characters changing their names all the time. They're like halfway through the play, yo, my name is now such and such. Oh shit. But you know, I know. So maybe he's somebody or she is somebody who changes their name. Maybe. There are a lot of people, especially recently, who've changed their name. Like this to Caitlin. And you know, that's like they become a new person. Or a different version of their self. But it is a little unnerving to have your character. You don't feel like you have the right name for them.
Yeah.
And
they sort of are vibrating in a way that's not helpful.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and they're sort of fuzzy and kind of like this. Yeah. You know that it's the right name when they stop vibrating in a fuzzy way that's unhelpful. Right?
Mm-hmm.
So you know when it's going to be the right name. Right?
Mm-hmm.
How do you find it, though? Right?
Yeah. I mean, for me, like, he's sort of an everyman character where really the people around him are more interesting, yet, you know, he's sort of the observer of them, I guess you could say. So,
right.
I mean, this name feels better than the last ones because it fits into the theme of the overall story a little bit better. It's
right.
it's just new, and I guess I'm uncomfortable with the idea of, you know,
right.
changing him again for the sake of fitting with the theme, but it feels better this time through.
Right.
I just don't know if
okay.
I want to tamper with that element, you know what I mean?
I understand. All right, have you gotten to the end of your work?
Yeah, this is like the third draft I'm on right now.
Okay, and each draft you feel like, man, you need to tighten up
your
name.
Yeah, and I had the first table read up just last week, there's an invited reading next month that it's
okay.
going to be going up for. So they suggested, you know, why not keep his name and keep in the same theme as the other characters who's you've named in the same. And
right.
I did that, and it feels better. It just feels new, and I don't know if it's the right... title for this character,
yeah.
It feels
so,
better.
And but you're writing the draft with
yes.
his name.
Mm-hmm.
You could, I mean, just like for fun, maybe you try this on recording. You could just sit around and list like 10 really stupid names for
okay.
10 stupid names. And when we list 10 stupid names, like always like the second one, you're like, oh man, that's his name. Like
yeah.
that. So you could, you know, when you allow yourself to be, you know, just free and relaxed about it, you could hit on his name. Without sort of focusing too hard. I mean, not that focusing too hard is bad. You're doing great. And, you know, you'd have a table meeting, you have a thing, oh, that's good, doing everything right. It's just that maybe you just need to be a little looser about it. And if you pick 10 stupid names and you don't like any of them, then stick to the name that you've chosen for him and go forward and see.
Sure.
Because changing a name, like, you know, often isn't such a good deal unless you have a lot of, you know, things going on that resonate with that.
So there, being that it's just a two-person play,
right?
It's very long, and
right.
I've already kind of hashed at it. But
right.
I've also discovered some new things, and
okay.
then I'm like, oh great, I might add more than what I cut out.
Cool.
But there are like a couple of characters that you're spoken of, that I've spoken about that kind of fuel
right.
some of the tensions.
Right.
And like, is he the bad guy? Is he the good guy? Is he a stereotype? Is he, what is he? And why is, I mean, why does he have, I guess because he's the brother of the female character.
Right.
And so they're just such opposing views based on the incident.
Right.
Remember, it's in the, right?
Right.
And so I kind of don't know how to make it more balanced because it's so, opposite. I don't know if that makes any sense.
Right. Well, I don't see, she, Crystal's been working on her play for a while long
too
enough to work.
Way too long.
You've been working on it long enough for me to be a little familiar with it.
Yes.
And it's a two character play.
Yes.
And there's a third character who is never seen but spoken of.
Spoken of.
Right. And so your concern is whether or not you're sort of presenting him appropriately, or appropriate for whether or not you're presenting a fully fleshed out character, or kind of, I mean,
yeah.
I'm trying to get to.
Yeah, you know what I think?
What
you
know,
think?
I think. What do you think?
Yes.
Yeah.
But, you know, when I started writing it, remember, it was supposed to go more in the romance.
Right.
And then the whole right thing kind of was like, oh, this can't be a full romance, but we can play with the dynamics.
Right.
And I think part of why it shifted was because of everything that was happening just in our world.
Right.
You know,
right.
The black guys being killed by cops and stuff. And even though it takes place in the 90s and then 2006, I feel like a lot of that is kind of just an umbrella over my writing. And so I guess I don't know if I'm kind of staying true to the story, or am I just feeling so perplexed by the things that are happening now,
right,
that it's kind of, if it may shift the direction of my next draft, just as far as he's concerned. Does that make sense?
Yeah, I mean, it's like, how do I write what I want to write while
over your shoulder.
Right.
You know what I mean? Like, is it just somebody, now my characters just become me and my own thoughts and how I feel about the world.
Right.
And vice versa, in counteraction with the other characters.
Right.
Like, I guess, you know, I know there are always pieces of us in all of our work, but, you know, am
I... Oscar Eustace, our fearless leader.
You know,
yeah.
Is it Crystal as a Jewish guy and Crystal as a black girl from, you know what I mean?
Right.
Is it my thoughts?
Do you have a reading scheduled? I'm so jazzed by it, of course, because it's reading. Do you have a reading scheduled for your work?
For this
yes.
particular, not yet. It's
okay.
So long.
Schedule one. Even if it's your friends in your living room, I know they're looking at you like, what? Schedule one. It's time to, you know what I mean? It's time to make that thing. It's time to take that step. Come on. That's my suggestion. Get to the end, you've got to the end several times. Get to the end, you looked at me like,
It's okay.
I'm just like, schedule a reading. Even if it's two friends of yours, it should be two other people, not you and somebody. Two friends in your you know, living room, during the, you know, sometime in your kids at school, or sometime when they have a play date with some nice person, taking them to, or whatever. You know what I mean? Schedule a reading. You and a couple of people just to hear it, or just you to hear it. Do that. You got to get out of. You got to get off the Ferris wheel. Got to get off the mirror. Okay. That will clarify a lot of things. You got to put some distance between you and the play. You got to end it. Even if it's not perfect. Okay. Does that make sense? Can you do that? You got two friends. Yeah. Does that make sense? A lot of times that's what we need. You get all squirrely with this shit, you know what I mean? You've been working on it for a while, you know, you've been working really hard on it. It's time to get to the end, clean it up, set a date sometime in the next month, I'd say, before the end of October, and while on Halloween, and while on the day of the dead, okay? Okay, within the next month and a half, set a date, have a meeting in your home, low key, low stakes with friends. Okay?
Doing.
Oh, okay. Right.
For the stage, but now I'm hearing music.
Right.
So now I need to know how to turn my adaptation into a book.
Is that correct?
A book for music.
A book
yes.
for music.
Yes.
And
yes.
So what is the difference?
I think the difference is that when you make spaces for the music, you indicate song here, song about
so
X here.
Go. So do you then take chunks out of the dialogue or stuff?
You probably
should
definitely those spaces.
And to turn those dialogues of that dialogue into lyrics.
Exactly. Yeah.
So then
turn the dialogue into lyrics.
The lyrics, yeah.
Right.
So that would be.
Yeah, a scene, before it's a musical, there's a scene between Suzan-Lori and Carol talking. If it were something musical, we'd say, wow, that would make a great song. So we'd have a duet.
Right.
Yeah. Or you'd sing a song.
Yeah, that's the kind of thing that's like happening on a movie.
Yeah.
It is a musical.
Yeah.
And the other thing, the question I have is, if you have an opportunity, if someone says, what are you working on, and someone in the theater says, I'd love to read it. Why does that feel like I've just put the brakes on?
Huh.
So I'm not sure it's written. I don't want to misuse an opportunity, and yet I don't want to lose an opportunity.
Right. So are they a friend, a close friend, or are they kind of someone that you kind of don't know very well?
Someone I don't know quite well, but
okay.
Knows what they're doing.
Okay. So Carol's doing some work. She's written novels, and she often adapts her novels into plays. And now she's adapting one of her novels into for a musical. Or a musical.
That's what I'm thinking it might be. And that's what people are sort of telling me.
Yeah.
You're hearing it. I'm getting the music, writing it, the lyrics. And then I go back to see what I had it. But it's a really confusing way of doing it.
No. But what also sounds like it's confusing is someone comes up to you and says, wow, I'd love to read it. And it's someone that she doesn't know very well. So she's thinking, do I kind of blow my chance at, you know, impressing this person by giving something to them that I don't think is yet ready? Or do I go ahead and give it, or do I lose their interest by not giving it? It's like dating. Which would you do if you were dating somebody and you said, hey, baby, I know you're happily married, but say to them, like, hey, baby, you know, I've only known you for, I met you at this cocktail party, and let's go into the bathroom and, you know, would you do that? Would you be afraid of losing their interest? What would you do?
No, but if it's someone whose input is very well respected.
So does it.
Who would say, hi-oh. Sorry, I met people here just
She's so happily married. No, no, but if it's someone whose input that you'd respect, yes.
Right. Who would say, who would have the knowledge to say this is a musical or this is not a musical?
Right.
Why would I finish, you know, continue bumbling along with it if I could get an opinion that would guide me?
Just suggesting a portion, trying to say a little portion of it.
Yes. So come
just
on. So what,
bit.
Do you, what do you think?
Not the whole thing.
Okay. A little bit. Give them a little
dating
portion.
It just a little bit. Dating it out.
A little bit. Like give them like a little
right.
feel
little
or something.
Little
like
little
let them like kiss and make out. But don't like take any analogies.
It's so wasted on me. I'm married 54 years.
I'm married.
Rid of resistance. Maybe great teacher told you you were wonderful. We need more than that. You know, maybe your parents said you're swell. We need more than that. It's
I think one of the best pieces of advice I ever got, not just for writing, but just life in general, is don't take advice from someone who is not where you want to be as an individual, as an artist, whatever. So it might be good to put out your extremities and, like, you know, find somebody in your network that you really respect and you think, hey, he, she, whoever, is somebody who I think I would give you some good feedback and they're kind of where I want to be personally, professionally. Talk to that person or those people and say, look, this is a new thing for me, it's my baby, please be gentle, give me the best feedback you can, I want to improve upon this, but, you know, I would love some positive feedback and, like, you know, the, you know, chorus of praise.
That's
talk
a great, that's a great thing. Don't take, say it again, don't take advice, what were you saying?
The advice is basically don't take advice from someone who is not where you want to be,
really great.
Personally, professionally,
that's
whatever.
Great.
I think it applies to...
Where you want to be.
Yeah,
don't take advice...
Who is not where you want to be.
Want to
yeah.
be. But what if they are there?
Then
well,
take the advice.
I also find getting advice can be very helpful because if someone you really respect something, sometimes they give you advice and you're like, I don't want to do that. That's the most helpful feeling of all. Like, you might totally respect them and they're super smart, and you're like, oh, no, that's exactly not the point.
Right.
Exactly the point is what I planned on doing. Like, when I was a kid, I used to do eeny, meeny, miny, moe, but I was going to order at restaurants, and it's not because I would actually take it, it's because it told me, like, oh, you're disappointed that you got that one.
Yeah.
Right.
That means you wanted that one.
Oh, that's good.
So, like, when you get advice from people sometimes, because the person that you respect most in the world still can't tell you how to write your work.
Right.
But they can sometimes tell you, like, oh my God, I've been avoiding that idea, but you're totally
right.
Or they can tell you, like, no, that was the whole core of it. Like, you might hear someone say, like, don't make it a musical, and that's the moment when you'll realize, of course you're going to make it.
Right.
Yeah, it's like your guns, too. Like, it's your own unique invention, you know? It's going to be true to you, and so you want to stick to your instincts and all of that. You know, welcome feedback, but also know, okay, if I really feel strongly that this works, then by all means, stick to it and do it, you know? Like, one of the best things I ever saw was, I watched the movie Adaptation with Nicolas Cage, where at the very end, like, they say throughout the whole movie, don't use voiceover narration in your screenplay. But it's like, you know what? That works. I'm going to use it. And sure enough, at the end of the movie, he's doing voiceover narration, and, like, it works beautifully.
Yeah. And that's interesting, though, because, it's two things. The best bet is to seek advice from people who are at a place where you want to be, and yet then you have to really be able to listen to your gut while listening to those people to know what you really want. Because sometimes it's easier if you just ask any random person what you should do. You know, they're not even important to me. And you seek out those people that you respect, and then you really have to listen in. That's good. So go forth.
Thank you all.
That's well done, you guys. Oh, I love this. Anybody else have a something they'd like to talk about? Or?
I grew my hair too much. Yes.
I was just like, I don't want to talk about that.
I'm sorry, I can't help it. Smart, very smart, and I've always been someone who listens.
question, but I'm like,
go ahead. You're wonderful.
I'm just thinking about, this has happened to me like 3 times now, where like I'll do something, and then I'll decide that I get really low. Like I get really, really low, like to the point that, like to the point that nobody wants to. I think my friends are all just like, oh, shut up. Do you know what I mean? Like,
right.
And I'm like, oh, maybe I should quit writing. Maybe I should do something else.
Right.
And not blah, blah, blah.
Right, right, right.
And then that'll go on for like 3 weeks or a month. And then like all of a sudden one day I'll have it and I'll do a new draft.
Right.
And it'll be very different than the
right.
draft I had.
Right.
And like, I know that like this is the draft.
Right.
This is the draft that like I'm gonna work with from now on.
Right.
It's gonna be. I'm
right.
not gonna. I'm just thinking about. Do you know people where like that kind of like depression is just part of the process? It's
right.
something I'm gonna have to live with.
Right.
I'm gonna have to know that like, okay, like you're feeling that thing where you're gonna give up.
Right.
But what that really is do you know? Yeah.
Yeah.
Because it just feels like. Okay. Well, then there's my.
I think if your idea was good enough for you to embark on the long, arduous process of writing and rewriting and like putting 120 some odd pages on paper, it must have been a really good idea. It would like make you jumpstart all that stuff. So like remember why you started and it'll help you finish it.
And surround yourself with like-minded people who care about you. This is one of those places. And I just make fun of your hair because you're such a fabulous writer.
Picasso, to your point, Picasso said that. Picasso said,
terrible.
Okay. It's 6:30.
I have a meeting with a rapper tonight who wants me to write music.
Did you have something?
No, I'm just sleeping.
Oh, you're just
sleeping. Yeah.